Hello, my friend. This time we're going to cover only one subject, but strong enough to decide the future of the space industry. Let's see what we can make out of the updates regarding Russia withdrawing from the space station and which companies could replace them. While war between Ukraine and Russia is going on in full-fledged manner, questions have arisen about what will be the future of the International Space Station, which is based mainly only by the two superpowers, US and Russia, along with a few other countries. How will the activities in the orbiting lab be affected after Russia withdraws its support from the project after 2024? And what steps will NASA have to take to cope with the situation? And how will the commercial space agencies be able to keep the station alive? These are some questions which trigger our mind. So let us look into the scenario for answers. In the midst of the Russia-Ukraine war, the rift between Moscow and Washington over the Russian invasion and economic sanctions is continuously increasing. Just a couple of months back, Dmitry Rogozin, former head of Roscosmos, had stated that Russian involvement in ISS after 2024 are possible only if the US sanctions against the Russian space industry and other sectors of the economy are lifted. In response to the sanctions being imposed by the US, Rogozin had also threatened that they'll crash the space station on Earth by deorbiting it from their section. The feud has grown further when Roscosmos posted photos of their three cosmonauts holding the flags of two self-proclaimed republics in eastern Ukraine, where Russia launched its invasion. The post marked the capture of Lyshank and was captioned, "A Liberation Day to Celebrate Both on Earth and in Space." NASA strongly condemned Russia for using the International Space Station for political purposes to support its war against Ukraine, which is fundamentally inconsistent with the station's primary function among the 15 international participating countries to advance science and develop technology for peaceful purposes. Despite these events, NASA had tried to keep the space program meant for civilian benefit to remain unaffected by the war situation. NASA Administrator Bill Nelson said, "Russian cosmonauts and American astronauts are all very professional. Despite the tragedies that are occurring in Ukraine by President Putin, the fact is that the international partnership is solid when it comes to the civilian space program." On the 15th of July, NASA and Roscosmos had also announced an agreement to launch NASA astronaut Frank Rubio aboard Russia's Soyuz MS-22 spaceship in September, and Russian cosmonaut Anna Kikina to launch aboard SpaceX's Crew 5 Dragon. NASA has repeatedly stressed that its astronauts and Russian cosmonauts aboard the station continue to work side by side as they have for years. Robin Gattins, NASA director of the ISS, said that NASA didn't want to see the partnership come to an end. She said, "We're planning for a transition after 2030 to commercially owned and operated space stations in low Earth orbit. We're thinking about a transition as well." But still, the breakup seems inevitable, as recently Roscosmos, under their new chief Yuri Borisov, announced on the 26th of July that they will withdraw from the International Space Station project after 2024. With Russia going off from the ISS, it'll mark the end of an era of cooperation between two old rivals. During Borisov's meeting with President Vladimir Putin, he stated that Russia will focus on the development of their space station completely after 2024, but it didn't cancel the 15th of July agreement. "We will fulfill all our obligations to our partners, but the decision to leave the station after 2024 has been made," Borisov said. But Russia's hesitation to leave the ISS was clear when on the 29th of July, Borisov revised his comment. He said, "We stated that we intend to do so not from 2024, but after 2024, hinting that Moscow will remain on the ISS at least until their own Russian orbital service station is built by 2028. Sources state that the draft design of the station will be completed in the third quarter of 2023. Now, sooner or later, Russia is going to leave the ISS, so it's now up to the US and other members, Canada, Japan, and European countries, to continue the space station's existence till 2030 or later. The two sections of the station run by NASA and Roscosmos are interdependent. While Russia is responsible for the space station's critical propulsion and control systems, the U.S. segment is responsible for the power supply of the station. So it's unclear whether the International Space Station can be continued with one side quitting the project. On the good side, most part of the station belongs to the U.S., and the Russian part comprises about 17% of the space station's mass. But the Russian section contains the most important Zvezda service module, which is the engine of the station that enables it to maintain its orbit and maneuver around space junk. So after Russia's quitting with Zvezda, NASA must replace it with a new service module in order to continue the space station. And for this new module, they'll have to give a contract to any U.S. company or possibly any other company. According to sources, Russia's withdrawal will also deprive the space station members from using the well-proven Soyuz rockets to get to the station. Mubdi Rahman, the founder of Sidrat Research, commented on Russia's announcement, "To be quite frank, the U.S. and the rest of the world still don't have a viable, well-tested solution to get to the ISS. Russian space vehicles have been the reliable ones to get people up to the ISS. As per some analysts, this breakup will set back scientific research and potentially lead to an increased militarization of space. And it will lead to reduction of hopes for cooperation on joint scientific projects for the benefit of humankind. But we know every problem leaves behind a solution, and that's not different in the space station case. Russia's withdrawal will make the station inclined towards the services of private aerospace companies. And in the services of private companies, SpaceX's name comes first. With its reusable launcher fleet, it's already proving huge services to NASA in crew and cargo missions. And SpaceX's Falcon 9 and Falcon Heavy can easily replace Russian Soyuz in a much better way. So SpaceX has a high chance of getting ISS contracts in much greater numbers. Boeing's Starliner spacecraft, though in its testing phase, is still a good option as a spacecraft to get to the station. Earlier, Boeing had served as NASA's prime contractor in developing the space station in the 1990s and 2000s, and probably knows the station better than anyone else. So Boeing has a good chance to develop the Zvezda replacement module. Northrop Grumman, too, can be incorporated for developing the Zvezda replacement module. Northrop's Cygnus supply ships can get to the station. Sources state NASA is planning to use Cygnus's engines to correct the orbit of ISS in the future. Moreover, Northrop has also won launch contracts to build a habitation module for NASA's planned lunar space station, the Lunar Gateway. So Northrop, too, stands a good chance to get an ISS contract. For backup to the International Space Station, NASA has already awarded contracts to Blue Origin, Sierra Space Ally, NanoRacks, Lockheed Martin Ally, and Northrop Grumman back in 2021 to develop commercial space stations. But how much time before the ISS's demise they become operational isn't clear. So a fear remains that after decommissioning the ISS, the U.S. may have to wait for the commercial stations to become ready, leading to absence of U.S. presence in space for quite a time. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting. And kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comments section. This will help us to improve.